really feeling honored to be here. So I'm not a community organizer, I'm a sociologist and I'm an ethnographer, but definitely there's a lot of overlap between what community organizers do and what we as sociologists do to sort of problematize things with certain perspective. So in this presentation, I wish to problematize the idea of queer community in the specific context of India, as this country, India, has recently witnessed in September 2018 the reading down of Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code, the colonial law which remained in existence for more than 150 years to subjugate erotically marginalized subjects. So, with the hindsight, I would emphasize that the idea of a marginalized community, and here the queer community, cannot be understood without unraveling the contestations and conflicting interests of different segments within the community, and to see these different segments, how they connect to structures of power and privilege on the one hand, while others remain outside the circles of power and privilege and pushed into the material conditions of certain poor material conditions of life, state, market, media, popular perceptions, along with the privileged within the community, articulate a given community as a homogeneous group, reducing the problem to the legal domain and visibility, invisibility issues. But no one except the most marginalized within the community offer a radical and nuanced critique of power structures. And while doing this, they also expose how privileged within the community are blind to the complex issues of the subalterns and guiltlessly participating in a system which might subjugate them in some ways while bestow comfort, power, prestige, and dull their sensibilities to interrogate deeper malaise within the system. So these are there are no direct one-to-one connection between the multiple disenfranchisements and emergent pedagogy of the oppressed in Paulo Freirean sense of the term. Nonetheless, there is a likelihood and possibility of offering deep and penetrative reflections due to positioning in multiple waves of marginalities and dominations. So so what I'm doing here, I'm also an ethnographer, so I'm doing an ethnography of the online reactions which came up after the reading down of 377 in 2018 in India. So I'm reading this out, what I've written. When the mood was set to hear the reading down of Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code, and when the women judge Indu Malhotra, Supreme Court judge, begged the apology on behalf of the Apex Court for allowing the Section 377 to stay on the statute books, and with the subsequent Supreme Court verdict on 6 September 2018, the five-judge bench of the Supreme Court were projected to have set right the wrong a two-judgment had done in 2013. In 2009, the Delhi High Court had decriminalized homosexuality in India, but in 2013, it was again recriminalized by the Supreme Court judges. So I turned to Facebook and WhatsApp to understand the reactions circulating on these spaces. Though one could see multiple tropes emerging through multiple reaction, with one parodying the, and mimicking yoga guru and business tycoon Ramdev Baba. Ramdev Baba is a yoga guru, which is also favored by the present regime, the present government, and has come up as a very hegemonic figure of yoga, you know, representing and trying to be synonymous with yoga, yoga instructor. So he used to say that he has a cure for homosexuals. Now the homosexuals are saying that perhaps homosexuals have cured Ramdev Baba. I was confronted with enthusiasm, celebration, and euphoria on the one hand, while introspection, unease, concern, and mindful ruminations on the other. I could just see on my smartphone a group chat popping up through Facebook Messenger. 4 to 6 gay men, who are gay men of 30 plus, and also working in corporate sector, who are supposedly in 30 plus age group, were conversing about a party arranged at a corporate hotel, which is called Lemon Tree, located in corporate space of high-tech city of Hyderabad. The participants in the chat are all gay men, with most of them corporate employees themselves. Someone says the Lemon Tree event page filled with celebratory scintillations, and it reads, it's been a long wait. The cross fingers have begun to hurt. Tomorrow, 692018 is a judgment day. The judgment for which we have been waiting for bated breath. Let's get together and celebrate, hopefully, this moment in history, which has huge impact in our lives. Together is better. Now it needs to be asked, who would constitute this together? And who subsequently got together at Lemon Tree to celebrate the momentum? The conversation among the gay men would reveal the enclosure of this fellow celebration as it proceeds. Someone in this group chat inquires, free or paid? And A replies, free but limited. Apprehending that it might get overcrowded, A whispers to this close group of friends, cautioning them, let's keep it a separate. Shh. B reminds everyone about the parallel meet arranged in non-corporate activist space of the city, Lamakan, to celebrate the historic judgment, as he posits, what about the meet at Lamakan? Lamakan meet was advertised on Facebook on behalf of LGBT community by some members with activist leanings. The non-corporate Lamakan is not as sexy, as saucy, and catering to certain ideological undercurrents, which may not be as titillating and spicy to many of these gay men as C responds. The Lemon Tree event came as a surprise for me. Else, I was ready to book a flight impulsively and go party in Bombay and Bangalore. So Lamakan was not a priority for the C anyway. D intervenes, between who are the organizer? Are they related to Kesav Suri of Lalit Hotel? Lalit group of hotel, this Lalit Suri is a hotel here, and his son is Kesav Suri, who is also a gay, and he also filed a petition in the Supreme Court of India to read down section 377. But he organizes gay party, very elitist gay party. So he replies, this is the Pride Circle, a voluntary group of folks for inclusive policies at work. C interrupts, but I'm sure Kesav will be organizing one more grand party at his kitty chain soon. His party is called Kituka Party, Kitusu. So A reacts immediately. They already have parties lined up for tonight in Bangalore, Delhi, Chandigarh, Kolkata. Well, he's a flamboyant one, an awesome one. Kituka Party, the usual. F says, do the registration, and he types, grab your first free drink in the meantime. In the evening, all attend party at Lamakan Tree, and the photo circulated on Facebook and WhatsApp. They gentrified space in the polished square with no drag, no trans, no femme at play. Away from this hilarity, the other concerns on Facebook were expressed through anxieties, pause, musings, philosophizing, connecting queer celebrations with larger issues of political economy. Akhil Katyal, an acclaimed queer academic from Ambedkar University, writes on his Facebook page, celebrate yes, but don't let the government use 377 euphoria to deflect our attention from what is happening. He was drawing attention to the upcoming farmers' rally in New Delhi by posting an article with the same message from The Wire. Wire is an alternative electronic magazine. This article discussed the gathering of farmers and workers who had thronged in from different parts of 23 states of the country, suffering great inconvenience amidst rainfall in summer stints of Ramlila Maidan. These farmers and workers had assembled to demand revision of visits. Ramlila Maidan is a large ground located in New Delhi, which is allowed for religious festivals and major political rallies and meetings. So these farmers have gathered from all over the country. And they were asking for remunerative prices of agricultural products. The nose driving of garlic prices and the massive losses were the immediate concern. The procurement prices was rupees 1 per kilogram, whereas the cost of production came to 10 per kilogram. Satya Transman Nagpal, a trans man who also expresses critical concern of sexuality issues, writes on Facebook wall, has freedom come today? Freedom for the privilege, privacy of sex. freedom not for the sex workers in the publicness of her street. Mm-hmm. So sex workers do sex in public. And this judgment is verdict is talking about privacy of sex, sex in private. So who has privacy or the privilege of this privacy? Here Shatya trans man is highlighting the plight of trans women who are also forced to do sex work in public. The present verdict of Supreme Court puts a lot of premium on privacy of sex and sexuality as a private matter. Mm-hmm. Sexuality and gender are intricately interwoven in the lives of majority of trans men and trans women, and they tend to become notoriously public in as many of them are cross-dressing, adopting cross-gender identity, create hyper-visibility, and there is more public around transness than cis-normative gay men and lesbian women. Secondly, majority of working class sex workers and trans women sex workers carry out sex work in public spaces and cannot afford the luxury of privacy. Mm. Shatya is posing a question to privacy clause in the verdict and highlighting the missing publicness of sex and sexuality which inform majority of struggling trans communities. G.C. Mallard, another trans man, intellectual and activist, reacts, "In public today, LGBT people will celebrate together. Gay men and lesbians will pair with trans women, men to take selfies. Intersex people will mostly be absent except for a few. Cis hetero supporters will take selfies with all queers." What a happy world. But by tonight, we know where the parties will be and who will be at it. And who will be ashamed of it if we dance like Khairati. And I will explain who is Khairati. The publicness of our street celebration and privacy of a gentrified party. G continues, while he memorializes Khairati, the transgender person who was criminalized and tried under Section 377 way back in 1884, which is available on the internet called Queen Empress versus Khairati. And he writes, in a very poetic version, he says, "Dance, dance, dance, Khairati, in your sari on the streets of Allahabad. Your freedom comes 134 years, too late and in somebody else's name. But dance with reckless abandonment, like you have done all these years in the defiance of law." Here, G mentions the rather well-known historic trial known as Queen Empress versus Khairati, judgment of Allahabad High Court. The transgender person Khairati in 1884 was arrested and prosecuted under 377 of IPC on the mere suspicion that he was a habitual sodomite. Khairati was kept under constant supervision by the police and arrested upon being found singing dressed as a woman. The only incriminating evidence was distortion of orifice on the anus in the shape of a trumpet, a mark of habitual sodomite. Alok Gupta asks, here we are confronted with the crux of in the enforcement of Section 377. Is this offense meant to criminalize the act or people who appear to be likely to commit this offense? Khairati here becomes the body marked with signs and evidence that indicate the possibility of committing sodomy. So the lamentary, here we can reiterate how hyper-visibility and publicness of sex and gender along with caste and class mark the transgender body. Now the question is, what celebration do we need to valorize from transformatory politics perspective and community organizing perspective? The lamentary hilarity or the body marked with caste, class, gender, subalternity, and distortion. The insularity of corporatized, class-inflected, gentrified aesthetics of middle-class queer, or the grotesqueness, corporeality, and publicness of the life of Khairatis. While one can visualize the corporate cis gay bodies being integrated into the consumptive neoliberal economy, I could see the likes of Khairati hounded out and brutalized by the police in the same national capital of Delhi the very moment Section 377 of IPC was laid down. There have been incidents of harassment and violence against the poor transgender women, as Vatrika Rastogi writes that the incidents of harassment and abuse against the transgender and kinder women appear to have escalated ever since the Supreme Court judgment against 377 has come. The narrative of transgender victim, the video of which went viral on social media and have been mentioned by Vatrika, two, three policemen picked us up and took us in the custody. We were hung against the wall and tortured. They abused us verbally for a long time and they raped us. We had only been sitting and talking almost ourselves when they took us away. We beg for a living and nobody wishes to give us work. But if the police see us talking to people, they chase us away, they beat us. The lamentary, of course, cannot welcome such grotesqueness and corporeality of this victim who is poor, illiterate, and working class to compromise with his elite and corporate ambience. I also find, Now I focus on two things which are articulated in the verdict, in the Supreme Court verdict, which I find closely related. The articulation of sexual minority, how the law, the privilege within the community and the mainstream society construct the idea of sexual minority. And something which is called substantive justice, which is written in this verdict. These two terms apparently correlate yet contradicts at a deeper level. In American context, some queer theorists have argued that homo-hetero divide homogenizes LGBT category, negating class, race, and ethnic contradictions. If LGBTQIA plus are sexual minority on account of marginal sexuality and oppressed genders, then why there are more number of trans women who are murdered in America? Among these murdered and decimated bodies, the majority belong to transgender women of color. In India, the transgender women are still fighting the basic rights even when the right is extended through NALSA judgment. It is called NALSA judgment, which came about in 2014, empowering transgender. NALSA verdict of Supreme Court, which entitles transgender community with all vital rights, is being compromised by the government of India in its Bill of Transgender Persons' Rights, which is recently passed in the lower house of the parliament. The transgender communities are up in protest against this bill. The reservation in jobs, which is promised in the Supreme Court verdict, has been removed in the drafts bill. While the present government has proposed 10% reservation to economically backward members of the upper castes, recently it has failed to extend reservation in employment and education to the most marginalized segment of society, the transgender persons. There is a provision of screening committee in the bill which will give certificate of transgender identity, but the trans activists have refused this idea. One of the trans men says, if a cisgender person does not ask to strip before anyone to prove your gender identity, why should I? Begging, which is traditional occupation for hijra community and many hijras dependent on begging, has been criminalized. Recently, Delhi High Court has given a favorable judgment, but that is not applicable to other parts of India. Hijra women who depend on begging are fearing a threat to their livelihood. The recent anti-trafficking bill, the government is coming up with the anti-trafficking bill, which is also opposed by trans and sex worker constituencies. Because this bill is being contested and questioned by both cis sex workers and trans sex workers, as it strengthens the hands of police and bureaucracy in determining who is trafficked. So police has the power, according to this bill, to define who is a trafficked person. So sex worker doesn't have voice to say I'm voluntarily doing or I'm trafficked, but the police gets power to define this. So these institutions which are meant to protect trafficked persons are notorious for their human rights violation. Since majority of trans women are sex workers, they are also apprehensive of being caught by police for forced institutionalization. The victims of forced institutionalization have told their stories of being trapped under this draconian provision. Forced institutionalization takes away the right to earn livelihood, and there have been cases where these cis sex worker women have been, in the name of they are being trafficked, they are put into rehabilitation centers and separated off from their children. So one sex worker woman in Hyderabad came to the high court, and she was squeezing her breast to show that milk is coming out of my breast and my child needs this milk. You know, so these kind of forced institutionalization, which might also happen to transgender sex worker women, they are also fearing that. Now I take up the issue of substantive justice and transformative constitutionalism, which are spelled out in the document of this Supreme Court verdict. Transformative constitutionalism, as the nomenclature suggests, indicated that things need to transform with the changing needs of time. The idea of substantive justice has been incorporated in verdict from South African Constitution, which suggests fundamental socio-economic rights and equal opportunities to realize human potential. Given this, how do we look at the term sexual minority and queer community? We have, on the one hand, corporate queer middle class who would celebrate the Supreme Court's reading down of Section 377 with rainbow cake, which is also priced 377 rupees, in fancy restaurants, which are priced 377, and on the other hand, working class, grotesque corporeality of hijra women who are hounded out and brutalized by police and is still not accepted by the mainstream. We have more invisible categories of trans masculine person who hardly figure in the debate on queer. The substantive justice has been articulated, but the roadmap of this substantive justice has been left to queer movements to draw. So I do not think that the real revolution has come. The verdict is, of course, revolutionary, as women-loving women are asserting their rights by asking for legal intervention, and high courts have been supportive of such cause, but substantive justice can only be realized if these moves are backed with economic entitlements like employment and livelihood. So here I'm only talking about how do we problematize the idea of community, whether a community is a homogenized entity. If it is not a homogenized entity, then what it is? The whole idea of intersectionality within the community and how we choose a framework while mobilizing a community. From which perspective, which voice we have to privilege in community mobilization? Thank you.
Great. Thank you.